Hi guys, welcome to Chosen Explosions Kingdom Training. Today I'm going to be talking about Yom Kippur, also called Day of Atonement. I should have already had this video up because actually today is the 23rd of September and it is the Day of Atonement already. So I apologize for that, but it'll give you some information and maybe it will inspire you to learn more and maybe to even try to celebrate it yourself next year. Well, I'm just going to go ahead and get started with it. I'm going to begin by reading Leviticus 16, 29 through 24. And I'm going to be reading out of the Modern King James Version. It says, "And it shall be a statute forever to you in the seventh month, on the tenth of the month, you shall afflict your souls and do no work at all, the native and the alien who is staying among you. For on that day an atonement shall be made for you to cleanse you so that you may be clean from all your sins before Jehovah. It shall be a Sabbath of rest to you, and you shall afflict your souls by a statute forever. And the priest whom he shall anoint and whom he shall consecrate to minister in the priest's office in his father's stead shall make the atonement and shall put on the linen clothes, the holy garments, and he shall make an atonement for the holy sanctuary, and he shall make an atonement for the tabernacle of the congregation and for the altar, and he shall make an atonement for the priests and for all the people of the congregation. And this shall be an everlasting statute to you to make an atonement for the sons of Israel for their sons once a year." And he did as Jehovah commanded Moses. Okay, I'm just going to give you some facts about Yom Kippur. It occurs on Tishrei 10, which is this year. I already said September the 23rd. It's 10 days after the Feast of Trumpets. It's the most holy day of the Jewish year. It is considered to be the Sabbath of Sabbaths. The yearly big one, the big Sabbath of the year. Almost all Jews observe it. This marks the day that the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies to make an atonement for the sins of Israel. Blood sacrifices were made by the high priest and a goat was released into the wilderness to symbolically carry away the sins of the people. And guys, this was just done once a year. The priest going, making those sacrifices and going into the Holy of Holies to atone for sins for Israel. Okay, atonement literally means covering. The purpose of the sacrifice was to bring reconciliation between God and man by covering the sins of the people. Okay, it is the day of judgment for 1 year. And I feel sure that it points to the coming day of judgment, the eternal judgment day that's coming. Okay? Each person's fate is sealed by God by either inscribing their names in the book of life or not on this day. Okay? According to Jewish tradition. Okay? According to Jewish tradition, the book of life is closed and sealed for one more year on this day. It is the final day for prayer and repentance before the book is sealed. The very last opportunity to get your name into the book before it's sealed for the year. Okay? It actually is, according to some of the Jewish websites, it's a time of celebration. It's a time of great joy because they trust in God's mercy. And they're confident that he will receive their repentance and that their names will be written in the book of life for another year. Okay, the book of Jonah is read on Yom Kippur in remembrance of God's forgiveness and mercy. I do believe that that's a big theme of it, is God's mercy, and he is such a loving, merciful God. Like I've said before, the New Testament is full of the love of God, but the Old Covenant, the Old Testament is also, I think even more so evident, so overwhelmingly shows God's love and God's mercy. just how much he loves his people and that all he wants is for them to love him back. That's all he wants, is for them to obey him so that he can be good to them, so that he can bless them and keep them safe. That's the kind of God we serve. He's so good, so loving, and so kind. Okay. When the temple in Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD, the Jewish people could no longer present the required sacrifices on the Day of Atonement. So it came to be observed as a day of repentance, self-denial, charitable works, prayer, and fasting, or the affliction of the soul. The priests decided what they would do in order to continue to do their very best to observe Yom Kippur. They couldn't go into the temple to do it. They couldn't make the blood sacrifices anymore. So they did it in a different way, and it is by faith. Okay, this is how the Jews observe it. And I believe, guys, it's a little bit, you know, different from synagogue to synagogue, from Jewish family to Jewish family. But just generally speaking, this is how they observe. It's a solemn day of fasting. Some websites said 25 hours long and some says 26 hours long. That they take in no food or no water. Now that's serious fasting right there. Okay, no sex, no lotions, no perfumes, no leather shoes. That one's a bit odd. No bathing, no work, no writing. Shops are closed in Israel. There's no radio and no TV broadcast. It is considered disrespectful to eat in public on a national day of fasting. Okay? Instead of focusing on physical needs, they focus entirely on their spiritual needs. The idea is humility and to eschew luxuries and self-gratification. Guys, but this is what, you know, I think it depends on how they look at it. From one Jewish website, and I just love this. I'm just going to read to you what this person, let me see if I can find her name. The author is Deborah Maisel. And this is what she wrote in her article on Yom Kippur. She said, "The fasting of Yom Kippur is not a punishment or a restriction. It is a liberation from the limitations of this world. For one day, we become like angels, relieved of the obligation to eat, drink, or engage in other worldly activities. For one day, through the act of teshuvah, which is understood as repentance, but literally means return, we break through the iron wall that, according to the sages, hides the gift of heaven from the sight of earth." Wow, I love that. It's a very positive way of looking at it and truly understanding God's heart, because God never just tries to, you know, squeeze us like a lemon. You know, He never tries to do that. Guys, He always has a reason, a good reason for everything that He does. And so I just really like that. Okay, Yom Kippur commemorates the day when God forgave the Jewish people for the sin of the golden calf. 40 days after hearing God say at Mount Sinai, "You shall not have the gods of others in my presence. You shall not make for yourselves a graven image." The Jews committed the cardinal sin of idolatry. Moses spent nearly 3 months on the top of the mountain pleading with God for forgiveness, and on the 10th of Tishri it was granted. "I have pardoned as you have requested." Okay. To prepare for the fast, a meal much like their traditional Shabbat meal or their Sabbath meal is served. They say a blessing over the challah, a special bread that also accompanies the celebration of Shabbat. And after the meal, they light the candles with an accompanying blessing. The candle lighting and the challah blessing are both traditional acts that bring in the Sabbath and the other holy days. Okay? As a sign of purity, it is often customary for men and women to wear white on Yom Kippur. For example, men may wear a white kapot or yarmulkes. I think maybe I'm saying that right, which is fitted skull caps. Also, to signify purity, the scrolls of the Torah may be cloaked in white, and the ark where the scrolls of the Torah are stored is draped with a white curtain. Okay, Jewish tradition tells us how God opens the book of life and studies the words, the actions, and the thoughts of every person whose name he has written there. If a person's good deeds outweighed or outnumbered their sinful acts, his or her name will remain inscribed in the book for one more year. On Yom Kippur, the ram's horn or the shofar is blown at the end of the evening prayer services for the first time since Rosh Hashanah. Okay? Since the 100 blast of Rosh Hashanah, it is blown again on Yom Kippur. Okay? After the Day of Atonement ends, it is a time of great celebration because their sins have been forgiven and their names have been inscribed in the Book of Life. And I do believe at that point, they do a little party and they do some some feasting after the fast of Yom Kippur is over. It is a great time of celebration for them, and that's understandable. Okay, so after that is over, then they begin to look forward to the last main fall feast, which is the Feast of Tabernacles. This year, I believe it's on the 28th. And hopefully I will get a video of that one done as well and get it up before the day actually comes. Okay. All right. I'm going to give a little bit of a rundown on the services that they have on Yom Kippur. It is, like I said, a day of fasting. And they spend all day in services. Guys, they have five different services that they attend on Yom Kippur throughout the day, and each one has its own prayers that they recite, and each one has its own theme of what that particular service is meant to accomplish. Let's see. The gates of heaven are opened at the onset of Rosh Hashanah, opening the communication of man's sins to God. The celebration of Yom Kippur ends with Nidlah, which means closing the gate. The ark remains open during the entire service, indicating that the gates of heaven are open to these final prayers. Because the ark stays open, it is customary for the congregation to remain standing throughout Nidlah, which is the last prayer service that they have for the day. It is at this time that Jews make their final plea for forgiveness, asking that God seal their names in the Book of Life and so bring them a promise of a good year. Okay, and then the shofar is blown in the synagogue to signify the conclusion of the Nidlah service and the end of the Yom Kippur holiday. Nidlah concludes with a lengthy, loud blast of the shofar as the congregation exclaims, "Next year in Jerusalem." And of course they say it in Hebrew, and I won't try that. Okay. I wanted to read just a couple scriptures. Guys, we know that that Jesus, He is our atonement. The blood of Jesus has been shed once and for all, and anyone can be born again. They can receive Jesus Christ as their Lord. They can receive reconciliation between them and God, and that's what this is all about. You know, it's all about them being in right standing with God, and that's why the blood sacrifices were made. And because the Jews have not received Jesus yet, they have not received the Messiah yet, then they still do this each year, even though the blood sacrifices were not made. But they still do this each year to be in right standing with God, you know, to surrender themselves, to submit themselves to God, and to ask for His forgiveness. And that is their way. That is their way of being in right standing with God until their eyes are open, until they do receive the Messiah. But guys, we have received Him. And we know that the blood that He has shed is once and for all. And so when we celebrate this, you know, we do it acknowledging that Jesus, He is our atonement, that the work has already been done. So we do it, you know, if we celebrate it, we don't have to celebrate it. But if we do celebrate it, then we do so, you know, being mindful of what God has done for us already, and just being so grateful and so thankful that our names is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And guys, being so thankful that we can go into the Holy of Holies. Guys, He dwells on the inside of us, and that we can go into the Holy of Holies anytime we want to, simply by focusing on Him, by paying attention to Him, by entering into that holy, holy place with Him, guys. And one Jewish author I read on her website, she was talking about the Holy of Holies, and she said that was the place where heaven and earth became one. That was the place where heaven kissed earth, and once a year, the priest got to go in there. What an amazing thing. How excited he must have been. And it was a fearsome thing too. I mean, he could be instantly killed in there if he didn't do the appropriate blood sacrifices so that his sins would be forgiven with the bull and the goats before he went into that holy place. But guys, we've already been purified by faith, by putting your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And He dwells. We are the temple of God. He dwells on the inside of us. And we have access to Him. And we can go into that place, guys, where heaven and earth become one. Where heaven kisses earth. Where we become one with the Father. What an awesome, amazing thing. And we can do that anytime we want if we just take the time to pull ourselves away from the busyness and to shut everything down and to shut our thoughts down, to quieten ourselves down and to just focus on Him, begin to worship Him and to have communion with Him, to have fellowship with Him. Then that is the same as the priest going into the Holy of Holies, except we don't have to make any blood sacrifices. We can just enter in. Jesus already did it. The veil was ripped on the Holy of Holies, signifying that we have access to God, the Creator of heaven and earth, the Creator of all things, guys. If you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord, what are you waiting on? He's amazing. God is amazing. He's so wonderful and awesome. And He loves you so much, and He wants to forgive you. And you don't have to do these things. You know, all you have to do is turn your heart toward Him and repent of your sins, and He will forgive you. He will forgive you, and He will give you Himself. You will have an inheritance, eternal life found in Him. It's such amazing and an awesome thing. So guys, if you're watching this video, I know most of you are watching this video because you are born again, you are saved. But if you come to this video and you don't know Jesus Christ, if you've never had your sins forgiven by placing your faith in the blood that He shed, then do it right now. Just reach out to Him and say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Forgive me. Lord, I want to know You. I want to be in right standing with God. I want to please You. So, Lord, just come into my heart. Save me from my sins, deliver me out of darkness into the light. And if you will pray that prayer, if you mean it in your heart, if you will be willing to turn from your sins, guys, it's not just words. We have to turn from our sins, and He will help you do that. He will help you do that. And listen, if you fail, if you don't measure up, and who does? None of us do. Then that's what the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's what grace is all about. That you are forgiven. All you have to do is say, forgive me, Lord. Please forgive me, Lord. And try not to do that no more. And you will overcome it. You will overcome habitual sin. You will. None of us are perfect. We're going to fail and slip sometimes, but that's what the grace of God is all about. But He will help you to overcome all habitual sins and live your life holy and pleasing to Him. Well, guys, that's all I have right now. God bless you. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope you learned a little bit from it. But more than anything, I hope that it inspires you to dig deeper, to fall in love with the Word of God, to fall in love with the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, and to learn and to grow and to know God better, just to get to know Him more and more and more every day. Because guys, He's a deep well. We can never know everything there is to know about God. You know, I've been studying the Word of God for many years, at least. I mean, a serious student of the Word for 25 years, a very serious, hungry student of the Word of God. And I know that I've only began to tap the surface of understanding of God and His ways. And I'm just hungry. I want to know more. And I know that you are too. So dig into the Word and learn. Well, that's all I have for right now. God bless you guys. I love you. Bye-bye.